Welcome back to the EHAB Project Management course. I hope you're excited to start with Project Scope Management. This is the first knowledge area we'll look at. When you look at the PM book, there are three chapters before we get to the knowledge areas. The first knowledge area is Integration Management, which is in Chapter 4. But I prefer that you learn about other knowledge areas first, because integration is about integrating all the other knowledge areas. So you need to understand what you want to integrate first. Plus, we will discuss integration during all the other knowledge areas anyway, so it will be easy for you to understand integration later. Now, let's get to grips with the Project Scope Management. This is chapter number 5. What is Project Scope Management? Scope management is the process of defining what work is required for your project, and then making sure all that work and only that work is completed. If you are preparing for the PMP exam, you will want to remember this definition in the exam. Scope management controls only what's included in the project, focusing only, nothing else, no extras. Here's our mapping diagram again. Remember to download this from our website, ehabpro.com. You can see the scope management processes, which are colored blue. The scope management processes are the first processes in the planning process group, and they are also the first two processes in the monitoring and controlling process group. Don't be terrified looking at this. I will explain everything involved in these processes, and you will find them easy to understand. Let's start. In scope management, we have 6 processes, of which 4 processes take place during the planning process group, and 2 processes take place during the monitoring and controlling process group. When you get to the exam, remember these points. First, you must plan how you'll define the scope of your project. You also have to plan how you'll manage and control the scope. That means you will plan how to execute all the other processes. This is part of your scope management plan. This concept is implemented in all the other knowledge areas. You and the project team will gather the requirements from all the stakeholders involved in the project. We have to define the scope, which will produce the project scope statement. And we have the Create WBS process, which is the work breakdown structure, which we use in all projects. A WBS is a diagram which illustrates only the work you have to achieve or the deliverables for the project. We use this tool because it allows us to clarify the identified scope as well as find additional scope. During the validate scope process, you have to inspect the completed deliverables in order to get formal acceptance from your customer or the project sponsor or any authorized stakeholder. For sure, you will get at least 1 or 2 questions in the PMP exam about this. By the way, we call this process the sign-off process. The last process in this knowledge area is control scope. We always have to control the scope during the project. And as we said before, gold plating, which means adding extras, is not allowed in the project. Scope creep is the term we use to mean uncontrolled changes that make the team do extra work. You will get some questions in the exam about this too. We will talk about all these points in detail during this knowledge area. Let's have a closer look at the difference between project scope and project scope. You have to really understand both of these if you want to complete your project successfully. Let's start with the project scope. Project scope is simply the features and functions that characterize a product, service, or result. So, when people talk about scoping out their products, a lot of times they are talking about figuring out the features of the product, not the work that goes into it. It's important to remember this difference. For example, if the computer is the product, its features will be its processor, screen size, memory, hard disk, etc. Product scope is about the product details, which define what the product will look like, how it will work, its features, etc. For example, if the product is a mobile phone, the product scope will be its screen size, battery, processor speed, camera, memory, etc. What about the project scope? Do you remember the definition of a project? A project is a temporary endeavor undertaken to create a unique product, service, or result. So, that means the project scope is the work we have to do in order to achieve the desired result. For instance, if you've been given a project to create a software application, then the project scope will tell you how you're going to build it. The project scope gives you all the information you need to actually make this application. The product is part of the project scope. So sometimes the project scope is viewed as including the product scope. Remember, when we talk about scoping out a project, we mean figuring out all the work that needs to be done to make the product. As a project manager, this is a big part of what you have to be concerned with, the actual work that the team has to do. Another difference is that we measure completion of the project scope against the project management plan, but the completion of the product scope is measured against the product requirements. Product requirements includes things like software, technical attributes, security, user documentation, training, performance requirements, etc. The term requirement simply means a condition that must exist in your project due to an agreement or other specifications required in the contract. However, we'll talk about the requirements in detail in this chapter. At this point, we want to think about trends and emerging practices in project scope management. As we said in the introduction, you will find this term in the PM book in all the knowledge areas. These sections help you stay ahead of the curve. Since the world around us is always changing, you need to be aware of new developments and practices. Within project scope management, there is a recent trend of companies using business analysis to identify the requirements for the projects. As we know, requirements are a major focus for project management, and organizations are beginning to realize the advantage of using business analysis to gain competitive advantage by defining, managing, and controlling requirements activities. We have to ask how the product or service we create will stand out when it's compared to the competition. How can we make sure that the final outcome of our project will be appealing, that it will produce a competitive advantage? In today's environment, the way to think about this is, we are not just trying to create a product, we are also trying to make sure that it will stand out from the crowd. Project strategy is like war strategy. The aim is to win. In this case, by winning against the competitors using the product which we are making during the project. Business analysis may well begin before the project is initiated and the project manager is assigned. When a business analyst is assigned to a project, according to PM PUC, the activities related to requirements are their responsibility. While the project manager is responsible for ensuring the requirements-related work is accounted for in the project management plan, and that requirements-related activities are performed on time and within budget and deliver value. What does this new trend mean for you as project management professionals? You may well find yourself working closely with business analysts in a project. As we said before, as a project manager, you will be responsible for making sure the requirements work is accounted for in your project management plan, and that work is completed on time, in budget, and delivers value. Project managers and business analysts must work collaboratively. By understanding each other's roles and responsibilities, they can work together to achieve project objectives, so that the project has a higher chance of being successful. Looking at the project work itself, the emerging trend for scope management shows that the requirements management process starts with a needs assessment, which may begin in portfolio planning, in program planning, or within an individual project, as you can see in this diagram. The trends and emerging practices for project scope management focus on collaborating with business analysis professionals. We work together to determine problems and identify business needs, as well as identifying and recommending possible solutions for meeting those needs. We also elicit or find out, document, and manage stakeholder requirements in order to meet business and project objectives. And we aim to facilitate the successful implementation of the product, service, or end result of the program or project. You might remember the business case document which we create before the project starts. The business case contains all these domains. We discussed it at the end of chapter 1. You can refresh your memory if you need to. Now, let's take a look at tailoring considerations. You might remember that I explained the concept of tailoring in one of the previous sessions in chapter 1. But just to remind you, tailoring means determining what's appropriate for your project. Remember this concept, one size doesn't fit all projects. As you know, each project is unique. Each project may have different environmental factors, different cultures, different teams, different durations, different client, etc. So we can't consider that one approach is suitable for all projects. That's why we say one size doesn't fit all. In PMBOK, you will see tailoring considerations for each knowledge area. As a project manager, you shouldn't simply follow an international standard such as PMBOK, PRINCE2, ABM, or any other standard. You have to know how to assess a project to determine what processes you will need to adjust in order to achieve a successful outcome. Remember, when we're considering how to tailor the project management standards to our projects, we are asking questions. To assess the project tailoring needs, we ask questions about each of the project management knowledge areas, so we can decide which processes are needed for the project to be successful and which might need to be adjusted. So, let's look at the questions we need to ask in order to tailor the project scope management processes. First, we will consider knowledge and requirements management. Knowledge management is about making sure we have an atmosphere of trust within the team and with the stakeholders, so everyone feels motivated to share what they know and to pay attention to what others know. We will think about whether our company already has a system for documenting and managing knowledge, because if they don't, we will have to set something up. If you don't share knowledge, we won't have the full picture, and therefore, we have to establish a knowledge management system for this particular project. We will talk about this during the integration management knowledge area in more detail. It's the same with requirements management. For instance, maybe the company has its own methodology for collecting requirements, and maybe they have an effective way to do so, in which case there is no need to set up a new system, or you can tailor their method to suit your project. By the way, this is one of the processes we'll talk about in this chapter. The next tailoring considerations are validation and control of the scope. We should ask, does the organization have existing formal or informal validation and control-related policies, procedures, and guidelines? As we mentioned, there are two processes in scope management related to validate and control the scope. For instance, the validate scope process is relevant to the customer in order to get a sign-off for the deliverables. So you can't use one approach to get the sign-off from all customers. They might have different procedures or guidelines. For the development approach, such as agile, waterfall, or hybrid, we want to think about how exactly we will do the work. It's different for each project, based on the project type, based on the project size, needs, available information, complexity, pace, whether the project involves a new or existing technology, etc. For tailoring, we can ask, does the organization use agile, iterative, incremental, predictive, or hybrid approaches in managing projects? We also have to think about the stability of the requirements. Basically, are we dealing with constant changes? So we ask, are there areas of the project with unstable requirements? I will give you an example. When they built Denver International Airport in the USA, they decided to use a baggage handling system, which hadn't been invented yet. So all the requirements couldn't be known in advance. In that situation, we can say that the requirements are unstable because they are partially unknown. And if so, we want to think, do these unstable requirements require the use of lean, agile, or other adaptive techniques until they are stable and well-defined? In one of my previous software projects, the customer didn't know what exactly they wanted, and the technology being used was new for all the parties involved. So using Agile was the best solution for dealing with this challenge. And lastly, we have governance. Governance is associated with decision-making, oversight, control, and integration. We want to know, does the organization have formal or informal audit and governance policies, procedures, and guidelines? We talked about governance in detail in Chapter 2. Don't forget, as part of the project, you will need to document the tailoring process approach in the project management plan. Now, let's think about project scope management within agile or adaptive environments. We use agile methods when we are dealing with a rapidly changing environment. For instance, when it's difficult to define the requirements and scope in advance. Usually, agile is used in the software sector because we can deliver the project in repeated increments, so the customer can see the value from the beginning. This is the concept of a value stream. We know that in projects which have constantly changing requirements, significant uncertainty or risk, usually the scope isn't fully understood or known at the beginning of the project, and it can often change during the project lifecycle. The benefit of the agile approach is that it doesn't try to define and agree on a detailed scope at the beginning of the project. Instead, it spends more time establishing the process for refining and discovering the scope during the life cycle of the project. As you may have experienced before, especially in environments where the requirements are changing, there's frequently a difference between the business requirements stated at the beginning or in the contract and the business requirements which are really required. Using an agile approach allows you to build and review prototypes and release versions of the product for the customer to inspect, so the requirements can be refined as you go. How does this affect the scope? It means that you are defining and redefining the scope during the project. As you can see here, the process is repetitive. You can see that the requirements make up the sprint or product backlog. As we said, one of the core principles of agile development is to work iteratively, producing frequent deliverables. All agile methods apply this idea, with various directions regarding the duration of the individual iterations. The purpose of an iteration or a sprint is to advance the project by a significant increment, working from a task list or to-do list known as the sprint backlog. The backlog is a list of requirements or tasks in a given sprint. However, we'll talk more about this in schedule management.